The train stopped and we heard a loud command. Alle aussteigen. A Gestapo man told us that we would be given jobs according to our abilities, since many kinds of employment were needed to help Germany to final victory. He did not forget to add, if you try to escape, you will be shot. I never saw such huge facilities before. Domineering over this place was a heavily guarded IG Farben industry plant. The impressive looking chimneys emitted not always pleasant fumes. Something very important for the German war effort was produced at that huge plant. Around this plant, there were camps, many camps. The first night I spent in Camp 2, at 5 in the morning, an unpleasant voice lifted me out of bed. The capo selected 6 men for special training. At a water reservoir, 6 other men in striped uniforms stood next to a firefighting equipment. This was the only time that I came close to the Auschwitz concentration camp prisoners. We received warnings not to approach, not to talk, offer assistance or food to these prisoners. The 6 men standing there were in very poor shape. The expressions on their faces, their starved bodies, and deeply set eyes told clearly of a life of suffering and despair. The capo started shouting commands. The 6 men went through the fire drill with precision and unbelievable speed. Then it was our turn. None of us understood any commands. The results were a complete chaos. The capo yelled and cursed. After 5 tries, the first team received orders to instruct us. There were no other Slovenes among this free firefighting group, and I was wondering what kind of jobs they received. Auschwitz prison's complex consisted of, first, 3 concentration camps. Auschwitz I, known as the main camp, Auschwitz II, Birkenau, Auschwitz III, Monowitz. Number 2, many forced labor camps for men and women. And 3, Italian and French prisoners and workers had their own labor camp and special arrangement and special obligations. The majority of forced laborers were from Eastern Europe and from German occupied lands of Europe. Approximately 30 to 40 Slovenes were assigned to the forced labor camp for women. It was called Camp 3. The commander, a middle-aged German, welcomed us to his camp, warned us to observe all the rules, and left. The man had a slight limp. His office manager, a Croatian woman from Zagreb, then gave further instructions, work assignment, and told us a few facts. The camp consisted of 2 sectors. 1/3 was for the German and Volksdeutsche women. The other 2/3 were for women from the occupied Eastern lands, from Poland, Ukraine, Russia, but other nationalities were present as well. We soon realized they were under the command of the Croatian office manager. I do not remember the woman's name. She knew a lot about the situation in forced labor camps, spoke perfect German, and knew how to work with people of different ranks. That everything worked so smoothly in this camp was the result of her sincere concern for all folks in her camp. Everybody respected her. Daily operations were set up in a routine way. There were spot checks by Gestapo day or night, as we soon discovered. We considered every man in Auschwitz dressed in black uniform a member of Gestapo. It was advisable to keep distance from this man. Watching the women of the Eastern Bloc going to work, some starting at 5 in the morning, was depressing. They were very poorly dressed. Many had no stockings. Their legs were red bluish from cold. They were marching to their posts diligently, day after day, 6 days a week. Near to the east of our camp was the Monowitz concentration camp for men and women. Auschwitz secrets. From Polish prisoners, we tried to find out something about Auschwitz camps. Once one of them said that from 1941 on, transports of people were arriving daily, but there were roughly the same number of people in the camps throughout these years. He would not say anymore, even though we were urging him to explain. One of our colleagues came too close to the anti-aircraft smoke-making equipment. His warm winter coat just disintegrated. His request for a replacement was granted, and he came back with another coat. He reported that in this barrack there was a mountain of clothes, shoes, boots, etc. What happened to people? The truth about Auschwitz came only out gradually. Talking about these high secrets was in itself almost a dead sentence. There was no way to verify what was so secretly circulated. All prisoners in the forced labor camps were fully aware that the inmates of concentration camps had minimum chances for survival. This awareness kept everybody in the forced labor camps under constant control. There were only two punishments for breaking the rules: transfer to a concentration camp or immediate execution. The mass killings apparently took place before we arrived in Auschwitz. At least that's what we were told. We did not know either that certain groups of people were specifically singled out for extermination. Martin Gilbert offers the following approximate statistics in his book, Auschwitz and the Allies. A minimum of 2 million Jews had been killed there, as had as many as 2 million Soviet prisoners of war, gypsies, and non-Jews from all over Europe.